Today on Demo Part Breakdown, we're gonna take a look at this little guy here. This is a demo part that's headed to the AMB show in Germany not too long from now. We're gonna be making this part on the CM-1 along with a little help from this TRT-70 here. That's gonna help us handle all the 3+2 action that's necessary to get it done. I'm gonna sit down with Ernesto Flores, who's the applications guy that's responsible for taking this part from concept to completion. So let's go see what he has to say. So Ernesto, tell me about how you started out to develop this part.
Well, first of all, we had to come up with something for two shows. And one of the parts that everybody liked, I think, it was this part. So the way this came up was we're gonna have a CM-1 machine, a TR-70 trained in, and we wanted to showcase what type of part can we do to showcase both units, machine and rotary, and trainium, right?
And obviously that's too big for the
machine. Right, so something like this, you were looking at something like a TR-160 or something bigger. But being that we're using a small machine, this is what we wanted to end up at the end. So what we had to do is scale this part down. Couple of the features change, as you can see from this part. Mm-hmm. It wasn't 1-to-1. I had to stretch it out in order to make it fit to the material that we had. And the other thing is, you know, when we...
So you were using a long, like a more rectangular section.
Exactly,
kind of, right?
More, instead of a, more of a square than what this was done from the beginning. The other thing about this part is that we had a set of tools already. That we had to use from on the previous demo. So we wanted to utilize the same tools.
You didn't want to buy all new tools
exactly.
Just for that one demo, right?
Right. So, you know, make the best out of the tools that we had, and if there was anything that we needed to buy, then, you know, we would buy it. But for the most part, on this part, we're using the same tools that we have used previously, and this is the part that we came up with, and this is how it came out. We did change a little bit.
So on that part, this part is really only just the first op kind of. This one you have a finished part. Is there a reason for that?
Well, I mean, when we're working with the trainium, the whole idea is, you know, to get full five sides of the part and get a complete part in less operations. Like for this part example, I don't know how it was done, but looking at the features, you know, if it was done manually, it had to be flipped a couple of times in order to get everything done.
Right.
So on the TR-70, we're doing everything in one operation. The biggest thing about this part is it starts to get a little bit of a challenge is how are you going to hold it? Mm-hmm. Your work holding, it's critical, being that it's a smaller envelope machine. And you have to think, okay, am I going to use a riser on my vise? Am I going to have a tool setter on the table? Is there going to be enough room, you know, for all my clearances?
Especially in that machine, because it's
exactly
tight.
It's a bit tight. So you know, sometimes you have to get a little bit creative, and you know, you'll see it later on when we run the machine, how everything is really compact. Therefore, the name of the machine.
right.
So that's some of the things that you got to think about from the beginning when developing a demo. It's tooling, what kind of tooling you're gonna have. Work holding, it's essential. Programming, it's the big part of it too.
After you come up with a shape, what's the next step that you take in the development?
After we design or come up with the shape of a demo that we wanna do, again, tools, we define what tools are we gonna use. Work holding, how are we going to grab it? What's going to be op one, op two, or op three? Being that it's for a show, it needs to be pretty reliable. It needs to run the whole entire show. And we treat
it just like a production part. You don't want a failing in the show.
Right, so we want to treat this as a production part. You know, what's going to be easier for the operator? If it was on the shop or if it was on a trade show. During a trade show, you got people talking to you left and right. So we want to make it as safe as possible when loading the parts from operation one to the next. So that's the next thing is, you know, what's going to be the process, what's going to be the flow to get a complete part and be able to hand it over to the customer and say, here, take a souvenir.
That's one of the things you want to do at the end of it, is actually be able to give the person who's looking at the machine something to walk away with. Right.
And we also, you know, we want to showcase the machine, what the capabilities of the machines are.
So you added features on that from coming from this part here. You added features to showcase more of what that that trunnion's doing, right?
So the trunnion, you know, what we wanted to do on this part, we're doing the 3+2. In this case, it's full 5-axis capabilities. But in this case, we're just positioning. We gave it a couple of angles on this part to show a little bit more motion of the trunnion. Mm-hmm. We're only going to 90 degrees on this particular part, but there are cases when we have to go to plus 100 degrees. Then at that point, you start to get a little bit more creative on the programming side of it, mm-hmm. because you want to be able to verify that everything is going to be within distance, nothing's going to hit, and that becomes really critical.
Right.
On something like this, for example, on the UMC 750, I would model all of this, including the part, because I want to be sure that whenever I tilt plus 100 degrees.
Right, because it's such a weird configuration, plus the motion of the machine is.
Correct.
Right.
And versus this part, you know, 90 degrees, I think, based on your experience, you can have a pretty good idea whether your tools are going to be long enough and be in a safe spot when you're running the machine.
Right. So what were the, were there any complications in terms of programming it, or was it relatively straightforward? You were saying that, in this case, you didn't have to worry about modeling all of the entire rotary table and the fixture because your stuff's coming up to 90, right? And you know that if you have clearance to that side of the part, you're going to be fine pretty much, right?
Right. Not really. I mean, before we had DWO on our machines, it was really critical. This part needed to be exactly in your cam system the same way it was on the machine. If this was, you know, 1/10 of an inch off on your machine and on your cam system, you had it at zero, well, there was some mismatch in there. You got something different.
Right. You'd have to either have to measure that, you have to remeasure it, put that back in the cam system. Right?
So, you know, now with the ability of having DWO on the machine, it makes it a lot easier for the programmers, for the operator, because now I can set this part anywhere in space in the cam system, same thing on the machine. Mm-hmm. And DWO will follow that reference point that we give it on the machine.
Right.
That's, you know, 3+2 or 405 axis.
Right.
So that makes things a little bit easier from the programming side.
So do you have your X, Y, Z, zero at the center of the, like the center and the top of the part? Is that what I'm seeing there?
Or? This right here, this is where this is my second operation. And this is, again, the most complicated operation, because this is where we're going to be working with, you know, all sizes of the part, mm-hmm. right? So on this case, I have my work offset right on top of the part, right on center of my material. So in this case, you know, I don't need to worry about the trunnion or the dovetail.
Right. So if you're a little more concerned about what your clearances are, you would model all of that, of
right.
course.
Right. So yeah, if that had something like had to be really stubby in order to get here, real small tools. My biggest concern, I think, on this part would be my tool holder hitting this bolt.
Right.
So if it's going to get that critical, then yes, you do want to model this part and have everything verify. But
and it's not because you need to do it in terms of, like, DWO is still helping you out, but you need to know that it's better to verify it
exactly.
here than on the machine.
You know, you want to feel comfortable just
right.
for reference.
Right.
You do want to verify it. Again, it depends on how the complexity of the part.
Mm-hmm. On this part. So is it pretty typical on that machine, on the CM-1, for you to use the dovetail fixturing? Is that usually the way you're going to hold parts in there because it's so small, or?
On this machine, it varies. It depends on the part. If we do have clearance issues regarding tooling or whatever feature it's on the part, mm-hmm. the best way would be to go with a dovetail, something like this, because you have more clearance to get around it. But sometimes, you know, we can use advice as well.
Right, if you're just working on the top or the size of the parts.
Right, your piece is large enough, you know, where advice is going to be able to hold it and not worry if any clearances, then that would be something that we can use. My main concern here is, you know, when I verify this part, is am I going to be able to see all the features that I'm planning on how to program it on my verification? Now, that makes it easier too, because when you go to the machine, you already know which way the machine or how the machine is supposed to move. So you feel it, more comfortable.
It's a double check of what you plan to have
exactly.
Happen motion-wise is actually happening, right?
Right. So, you know, once you have everything set up, of course, if you have your tools defined, your material defined, and your work holding, this is where you will actually see it.
Right.
But just for reference, for me, all I really want to see is the end of how the part is going to look.
Right.
And so it's you know, nowadays it's pretty easy to catch everything here on the CAM system before you even go out to the machine.
And in this case, this is good enough. It's pretty much just knowing that the geometry of the part is being made correctly. It's not that you're going to have a collision or something, right?
Right. So on here, what I want to do is, am I machining, am I hitting all the right points that I want to be able to see when the part is complete?
Right.
And so looking at the model and looking at the part, I feel more comfortable going to the machine and hitting the cycle start and not worry about any collision. Again, even though tools are not being defined, but I'm pretty comfortable on how my tools are already set. And again, keep in mind that we're using the same set of tools that we have previously used. So this will be the second time and on a similar material diameter.
Right. So yeah, that part of it's already kind of proven out.
Correct.
Yeah, you're confident of that already. So I know we typically do either, our materials are usually aluminum or steel.
Right.
Why'd you pick steel in this case? Is it?
Well, I mean, on steel, I think you show a little bit more of the machine capability. Nowadays, it's more of a faster feed rate with less engagement of the tool.
Right.
So you're actually, seeing more of the machine capacity.
So on the fixturing for it, you've got a vise that has two stations, and then you have the rotary table. I think a lot of people are familiar with it, but what's the general idea of how you go from the vise to the rotary table and then back again?
Well, the first op, the way you want to think of it is, how am I going to hold this part on the trunnion? How am I going to do the features that you see on the print, and at the end, how am I going to end up with a complete part in the less amount of operations possible?
Okay. So this part is just 3+2. It's relatively basic movements from the rotor table, but it is designed to handle like full 5-axis motion, like you're going to be doing on dental and medical industry stuff, right?
Right. So the idea of having a TRT-70 is, to be able to utilize it on a CM-1 machine, which has the RPM up to 50,000 RPM. So, once you get into the small tools, a lot of the customers that are using that type of machine is, like you mentioned, medical, it's jewelry, and all those tiny tools that they want to use, the RPM is needed.
Right.
So for full 5-axis, that's the ideal trunnion. It's small enough, where it can fit a small vise and still have a pretty good part at the end of the cycle.
But, so are they going from essentially, I mean, I know the parts are small, but relatively speaking, are they going from kind of hogging out the stuff typically from billet, or are they more like, are we near net shapes or something like that?
Yeah, most of the time, it's from billet. On a dental part, for example, when they modify or they're building or creating a full denture, it goes from a billet. So they just leave it, 20 or 30,000 holding per side, so they can come in and cut those off.
So they've got roughing. They have, they're small, but they have roughing tools still.
Right.
Oh, there's
some roughing, right.
Right.
And there's a lot of roughing, especially, again, once you get into the medical parts or jewelry, the finish is really important. So the speed of the machine, the RPM of the machine, the speed of the rotary, the trunnion, all that come in play in order to get a finished part.
Right.
Okay, so the process on getting this part completely done is, you know, we take the piece of raw material, load it into the vise, and then we come in with an angle cutter to create the angle that we need to hold
the actual dovetail shape.
The actual dovetail tool, correct. And after that, if you can see here on the fixture, there's a little pin. That's the locating pin, so we know every part, whenever we put it in here, is always going to be in the same location. So then that's needed for most of the dovetail fixtures. So that's a different tool that does that operation, or where we create a slot on the part itself.
So it always stops in the right place. Is that so you don't have to probe the part? Would you have to probe it otherwise, or do you still probe it, or?
If it's a second operation that you're doing, or a third operation, and you're using a pin for location, I would probe it just to ensure that the part is right on center where I wanted it to be. But if in this case, you know, it's not really critical, so it doesn't need to be probed. Operation two, what we do, again, just because of the different features that we have, we want to get the basic structure of the part. So we want to do the profile first, so we have enough clearance when we start doing on the machining. So we wrapped it out on the top. So if you can see on this part, we have a small pocket in here and there's a hole in there. Well, one of the things you got to think about when creating the pocket is you have to have a pilot hole in order for the end mill to come in and do its work. Otherwise, if you come in on a pure material, there goes your end mill, right? There's no relief for the tool to go to. So we did that part of the feature of the part. And then when we turn 90 degrees, we're using a 6mm end mill to create the pockets on the side. And same thing on the angles. We're coming with a 6mm and just milling the corners off in order to have a flat surface. So the next operation will be the drill. So by the time the drill comes over, we already have established a flat surface. And from there, we go ahead and deburr the part, and it's ready for op three. Once we have it on op three, one of the things you got to think about is when you have a part like this is, well, how am I going to hold it? Is it going to be on a regular jaws, or am I going to have to create a pocket with the shape of the part? Mm-hmm. This being the case that the part is small, and you know the type of radius we have here, we had to create a pocket on the device.
You didn't want to just clamp it in a set of straight jaws.
Right, no, because then we would be only tightening the part on the radius.
Right, a lot of pressure on those outside edges there.
So what I decided to do was just create a pocket so it becomes more reliable. And again, it just drops into the pocket and the operator doesn't have to worry where is it gonna go.
Right,
So
because even if you had regular straight jaws, you'd still have to make a pin or something to stop it, right?
Exactly. Right. So in this case, I'm using the shape of the part itself to use it as my location point. In order to run the third operation.
Right.
So once we have it in there in the vise for the third operation, then we come in, we remove the extra material, the dovetail, again, using the same tools that we use on operation one, operation two. Mm-hmm. We're gonna use a 6mm end mill to go around and cut that off. And we use a 3mm end mill to create basically the whole pocket, which is the same tool that we use when we created this lot in operation one for the pin locator.
You're using a lot of over and again, which just makes good sense.
I mean, that's something that you want to think about, when creating a part is how can you make the most useful out of the tool that you currently have on the spindle? I mean, for the shows, for a demo part, we switch a lot of the tools back and forth just because we want to showcase the machine. But in the real world, you want to keep, the tool as long as possible in the spindle from operation one, two, and three.
Right.
But in this case, we go back and forth.
So in that case, that tool is doing work on op one position, on the trunnion, and on the third op position as well.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. So it's actually it's working the way you would normally in production.
Correct.
Right.
Correct.
So you've told me all kinds of cool stuff about this part. Thanks for sharing it with us. I hope it goes great at the show. And for those of you watching, thanks for joining us.